This episode of Brains Matter is sponsored by Swinburne Astronomy Online. For further details on online astronomy degrees, please visit http://astronomy.swin.edu.au/SAO. Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy. Hello everyone, and welcome to episode 76 of Brains Matter, the number one podcast hosted by an ordinary guy that comes out of Melbourne, Australia. On today's show, I've got the conclusion to the interview with Dr. Richard Stancliffe from Cambridge University on first stellar generations. If you haven't listened to episode 75, go back and have a listen to that so it'll give you a good context before you start listening to this show.
You take your spectra of your stellar spectrum, and you go out and you look for the abundances, and then you take the observed ones and you go to the modelers and you say, okay, make me an explosion, you know, evolve me a star, blow it up. What do you get? And based on what you know, the modelers will come along and say, well, okay, well, we've got this, and the following amounts of it. Mm-hmm. The observers will look at their spectra and work out the abundances that they've got and go, we don't. What's going on? So it's an interplay between what the theorists think they can come up with their simulations and what the observers are telling us is really out there. So currently there's a competition for who can go and find the most iron poor star, and astronomers tend to measure the iron abundance in terms of the ratio of iron to hydrogen. Mm-hmm. And because they're astronomers, they like to compare it to the sun. I mean, it's nice to have a reference. Mm-hmm. And because we're slightly mathematically minded, we compare it on a log scale. And so there are numbers that get floated around to go with these measurements. And so you'll typically hear someone talking of an Fe over H of a particular value. Mm-hmm. And so if you put the sun on this scale, an Fe over H of zero, it would have an Fe over H of zero because it's measured versus minus the solar value gives you the answer. So the two most metal poor stars known to date have this Fe over H value of -5. So that's 100,000th of the solar value. And so we're talking about things that really are, you know, they've got a lot less metal in them than we currently have. Mm-hmm. In the sun. 100,000 times less is considerably a lot less iron than we have. Mm-hmm. Today. And of course, just to add confusion to the process, one of the particular objects that we've got, in fact, it is the most metal poor one with an Fe over H of -5.6. has an awful lot of carbon in it. In fact, it's got enough carbon in it that it's only got about 1/10 of what the sun has.
So does that mean it's got to a certain point where it's converting to carbon, but it hasn't actually got to the next point yet?
We don't think so. Because the problem with stellar nuclear synthesis is it all happens it mostly happens in the center of the star. Mm-hmm. That's where the temperature is hottest. That's where the reactions are most likely to take place.
Yeah.
You've then got to get it out of the star. So sitting in the center, you've got all this layers of material around it.
Which is generally the lighter.
Which is tends to be the less processed star. So yeah, you may be able to form carbon in the center of this star, but it's probably not going to get out. So we think what's happened here is that there's been some explosion process that's probably produced the iron. Maybe that explosion process has also produced the carbon as well. Unfortunately, the models don't agree with that. Early supernova probably can produce the iron fine, but they don't produce the right ratio of carbon to iron. So maybe what's happened here is we're actually looking at contributions from a couple, maybe more stellar generations, where some have exploded and provided us with some iron. Something else has gone on and provided the carbon. It's all got mixed together in a big stellar gas cloud somewhere. Mm-hmm. And then the star is condensed.
So what's the situation where if you have a couple of first stellar generation stars and they're in some sort of binary format, and they go through this process, and one of them evolves slightly differently to another because of slightly different masses, and then you do a measurement. Is it possible to tell that there were more than one?
I think down at the very first cellular generation, that's going to be really tricky, because as I said before, we think they were probably massive, they've probably been and gone.
Yeah.
As we come to more recent times, there are a whole class of stars out there which are called the carbon-enhanced metal poor stars, usually referred to as KEMPs for short.
Imaginative astronomers.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Never let astronomers make acronyms, trust me.
Very large telescope array.
The worst is the overwhelmingly large telescope, or OWL. These carbon-enhanced metal poor stars, we think these probably are binary stars.
Mm-hmm.
And they're much lower mass than the massive earlier generations that we were talking about. So they're probably closer to being the mass of the Sun.
Mm-hmm.
And we think what's happened there is the more massive, sorry to say, mass is the key to cellular evolution. The more massive you are, the quicker you evolve.
Mm-hmm.
So you have this binary system, and the more massive star has evolved, it's managed to produce carbon, and it's possible in the low-mass stars that you can actually reach into the star and pull some of that carbon up to the surface by a process called third dredge up. There's a couple of earlier dredge ups in there somewhere, but they're not as interesting as the third, because it's the third that produces the carbon, that brings the carbon up to the surface. So these stars are sitting there, they're making carbon, we're bringing it up to the surface, and all the time they're slowly dying, but they're returning material to space through a wind.
Mm-hmm.
And so this wind is stripping material off the star. So then there's our little, the smaller of the two stars in the binary, and as the mass is being stripped off, some of it is falling onto this lower mass star, which hasn't evolved as far yet. So carbon-rich star is throwing off its mass and finally dies, forms a white dwarf, just a compact remnant of basically carbon and oxygen, cools down, and we no longer see it. But the secondary is still shining, and now it's covered in carbon.
Mm-hmm.
So we can see this carbon-rich, but still metal poor, because the low-mass stars don't produce iron when they die.
Mm-hmm.
So we see these.
So when we're talking about metal poor, we're not talking about the carbon there, we're talking specifically about the iron.
Yeah, so this is where it gets confusing. Yeah, these things are metal poor, but the carbon-rich ones are
still metal poor.
Are still metal poor. Then this is where it gets confusing, and we suddenly start having to forget about that approximation we made way back, that hydrogen and helium were okay and metals was everything else. Generally, when we talk about metal poor stars, we mean iron poor, because as I said before, we're using iron as a proxy for the age. So yeah, these things are actually, in some cases, they've got even more carbon in relative to the Sun than carbon to iron or carbon to hydrogen than the Sun might have. But yeah, so there we think we are seeing the signature of two stars orbiting one another, and one has actually received material from the other. Like I say, that's probably not what we've got for the earliest stellar generations, because we think they were massive. What we're seeing now is more likely to have been, there's been an explosion, a whole bunch of material's been returned back into space. Mm-hmm. It's got all mixed up with some of the primordial material that's still lying around. Mm-hmm. And then
gravitationally attract again.
Yeah, and then you form another generation of stars. Mm-hmm. You know, maybe those were also a bit more massive, did the same thing, and they spewed out more material, and then finally maybe we're actually seeing what we've got, what we can see today is, yeah, the generations we see today may be the result of sort of one or two or three previous populations of very, very metal-poor stars.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, the challenge for the observers is to go and push the limits and say, well, how many of these things can we find? What's the lowest metallicity we can get? And maybe if we're lucky, we will find a star where we're pretty certain that it's only been polluted by one previous star, and then we can say, well, yeah, that's our model. This is what we think should happen. This is what we're seeing. Link the two together.
So, if stars like that are discovered, will that help in understanding the evolution of the universe from the perspective of what happened right after the Big Bang? So, a lot of what we do at the moment is based on mathematical models.
Mm-hmm.
But this would probably give some additional observational information to that.
One of the reasons that people are interested in first stellar generations, and by this I mean the first, formed purely from primordial matter, is that, as I said before, the universe initially, we had the Big Bang, everything was very hot, And as it expands, the universe is cooling down, and we manage to form our protons and our neutrons and some limited amounts of nuclei. Eventually, the universe expands far enough that protons can capture electrons and form hydrogen atoms.
Mm-hmm.
But that's not what we actually see in the universe today. What we mostly see is just isolated protons, just hydrogen ions. Something has come along. So the thing about the hydrogen atom is very good at absorbing radiation that passes through it. So if the universe, again, we're lucky, if there still was a lot of atomic hydrogen in the universe, we probably wouldn't see this wonderful display when you go out at night.
Mm-hmm.
It's only because that there's this tenuous gas of hydrogen ions that you can actually see distant stars.
Mm-hmm.
So at some point in the past, something has come along and managed to separate the hydrogen atoms back into protons and electrons. And we currently think that that was probably the first stellar generations.
Let's take a bit of a break there and go to the listener of the episode. And today's listener of the episode is Alison Griffith from Melbourne in Australia. Thanks for joining the Brains Matter Facebook group, Alison. Now it's back to the rest of the interview.
Stars have collapsed. They've started to burn their fuel,
mm-hmm.
and they're releasing a lot of energy, shining photons off into space. And we
think the photons would have knocked off the
electrons. Photons are there to knock off the electrons and reionize the universe.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a lot of interest in how that process happened. And as I said, we think it's happening somewhere in the region of 100 million years to maybe a billion years after the Big Bang.
Mm-hmm.
So certainly people are interested in them from the point of view of what did they do to the universe?
Mm-hmm.
How was it that it comes to be reionized and look the way it does today? Whereas I just like my stars. I just want to know how they work.
So with our current sun, approximately what generation would that be, given that it's got a lot of heavier elements in there?
Lots.
Is there a way of determining what order generation is? I know it'd be very difficult to say it's the first, third, or 15th, given that we're 14 billion years old, but
yeah.
Is it possible to say this is probably in the order of the first five or the next 10 or something like
that? No, I'd say that's very difficult because you don't... Unfortunately, it's not a sort of one-to-one correspondence. You can't say that I have generation one, it produces this much material.
Yeah.
That then
some might produce more, some might produce less.
Yeah. And then there's a case of, well, you know, I have a big ball of gas. In the center, I form a supernova. I have a star that forms and goes supernova, mm. and it throws its material back into my ball of gas.
Mm.
Now, maybe a small chunk of that ball of gas then goes on to form the next stellar generation.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a guarantee that I've mixed everything up sufficiently well,
mm-hmm.
that new star that I form is, say, 50% of the old material and 50% of the new. Maybe it's 90% of the processed material and only 10% of the original. Maybe it didn't get very much at all. Maybe it only got, say, 5. So
it's like sorting a stack of cards. If you split it in half, cut the cards in two, and do an exact fold 1/1, then when you separate them out, if you measure it and you know what the previous stack looked like, if it was in order, you could say this has been folded, cut once or cut twice.
Yeah.
But if you don't cut it perfectly, you can't tell.
Yeah, it's a lot harder. The only sort of handle we have is we try and relate, as I said before, we try and relate the iron abundance
mm-hmm.
to at least to the age, based on the fact that certain stars live for certain lengths of time. You try and link it up and say, okay, well, if it's this iron poor, there could only have been stars of a particular mass that could have contributed at this point in time.
Mm-hmm.
And as the iron abundance comes up, that if there were smaller stars, then they would start to begin to contribute. So by the time you get up to the sun, you've probably had a lot of mixing of lots of different events.
And obviously with the number of extrasolar planets we're finding now, they're surrounding stars that are in multiple generations down the track.
Yeah.
So at what point would you think it would be feasible for planets to form around the star? So would that be within the last 5 billion years? Just as a sort of finger in the air kind of
I think it's It has to have been, certainly 5 billion must be reasonable because the Earth is here, right? And we think that the Earth is about 4.5 billion years old.
Yeah.
Certainly, from what I remember, a lot of the host stars for these extrasolar planets are relatively metal rich.
Mm.
So maybe the metals are important for the process of planet formation. Maybe it's not possible to form a planet around a metal core star because you don't have metals maybe necessary to help things condense out.
Because as a non-astronomer, the first thought I would have had is if you had a cloud of gas and you have gravitational attraction forming some sort of disc-like entity, if there is enough metal or other material, the scientific word stuff,
yeah.
Then there's a possibility of planets being formed. But if it's hydrogen, helium, the more likely scenario is that a binary star would form.
Possibly, yeah. It all depends on the physics that go into it and the process.
That's a very poor approximation, but
It's possible. That, as I said before, it's all about the formation process, and sadly, or maybe it's not sad, it still gives us a good challenge. We don't know as much about the formation processes as we would like to.
Mm-hmm.
At the minute, it's, observationally speaking, it would be very challenging to find, suppose that the planets did exist around metal poor stars, because a lot of these are older and further away, it's an incredible challenge to actually go and observe them.
Mm-hmm.
And so it would be hard to detect than with the current detection technologies and strategies. So maybe they're there, maybe we just don't see them, or maybe they're not there at all.
Given the age of the universe and the size of our galaxy and the age of our galaxy, would we have very many first generation stars within our galaxy, or are they most likely to have evolved into something else and been polluted many, many times and we just can't see them, but we know that the resultant stars have been created from those earlier generations?
So
I guess the question is, You mentioned earlier the Z5.6 star was the earliest one we found. Was that within our galaxy, or was it so far away that it took light that long to get to us that we could see it, but it probably no longer exists?
So the stars that we observe are actually in a big sphere around the galaxy, which is called the galactic halo.
Mm-hmm.
So the galaxy is essentially a bulge in the centre with a disk,
mm-hmm.
and around that there's a halo of stars. And so the metal core stars that we tend to observe are in this halo.
Mm-hmm.
The question is how that halo got to be there.
Because if they're in the halo, there's a higher probability that they've had less interaction with the other stars in the rest of the galaxy.
Possibly, or it all depends on how you think a galaxy might have formed.
Mm-hmm.
So the current thinking is that maybe what the galaxies formed by smaller galaxies becoming interacting with one another and slowly building up.
Mm-hmm.
The what we now think of as our lovely spiral Milky Way disk galaxy. So there's been a lot of interest in seeing. So you measure your halo and you say, okay, well, I've got stars that are this metal poor in them.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go and say, well, hang on, what's around us? Is there anything around us that might have similar degrees of metal, similar characteristics? You know, are these stars that are floating around the halo just some little poor galaxy that got too close and got shredded up, and we just picked up at stars and they're all floating around us? And then some indication that might be really what's going on here.
Mm-hmm. Well, given that Andromeda is going to hit us at some point in the distant future.
Fortunately, I'd say it's long enough away that, you know, I can retire.
Dr. Richard Stancliffe, thank you very much for your time today. That was a fascinating discussion.
No problem, it's a pleasure to talk to you.
And if any listeners have any questions, then please send them through to me and I'll try and get them answered for you. So thanks for your time.
No problem.
Thanks for listening to the conclusion of the interview with Dr. Richard Stancliffe on first stellar generations. I hope you found that as interesting as I did. Several of you have written in and mentioned how interested you were in the interview with Professor Roger Short about elephants. There are a lot of things in there that I learned, and it sounds like a lot of you out there in listener land learned as well. So in the next episode, I'm going to go and talk to Professor Short again, and we'll hopefully learn something new once again. So keep an ear out for that one. I'll leave you with a quote from Muhammad Ali. Silence is golden when you can't think of a good answer. Bye for now. Thanks for listening to the show. You can check out the Brains Matter website at www.brainsmatter.com. That's www.brainsmatter.com. And you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glen Goetz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.